Our guest this morning, I discovered him through one of our colleagues, Bob Burson, leader of the Northern Westchester Society. We Metro leaders get together once a month and we share good ideas with each other, and this was a very good idea. I've gotten to know Krishna and his wife and then his family today, and I'm delighted to introduce them to all of you. Krishna is a former partner with PwC. Tell us what that is.
PricewaterhouseCoopers.
PricewaterhouseCoopers. Thank you. I didn't have it all written out. I just had that. I should know that. is now co-chair of the Advisory Board of Global Financial Integrity of the Center for International Policy in Washington, D.C. He's on the Asia Advisory Council of Human Rights Watch and on the board of Aspen Institute's Business and Society Program. He sent in a description of his program this morning. I don't think I've ever seen one that were all questions, which is wonderful because I think that so much of ethical culture is in the question, and we love that. So here's some questions that he's going to be posing for us. What can be done to ensure that our financial institutions and multinational companies are not above the law? Why do these groups use tax havens so extensively? And is such use in the public interest? Is our legislative structure adapted to the interests or needs of these groups? And to what extent are the developed nations, US included, part of a system that deprives both rich and poor nations of much needed tax revenues? So we're going to be talking this morning, listening and participating in a conversation about taxes and social justice. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, Anne, and I'm very pleased to be here. The subject of tax and social justice may seem a little complicated, so I'm going to try to make it like a story. And we're going to weave like a tapestry to show you different pieces to the puzzle and how it affects all of us. Now, you know that the German theologian Dietrich Bonhoeffer is known to have said that the ultimate test of a moral society is the kind of world it leaves for its children. I'm sure that Dr. Adler would agree with that. The ultimate test of a moral society is the kind of world we leave for our children. So, with that in mind, I will try to explain to you some of the fault lines in the global system, some of the things that are working well and things that are not working well, and how it affects us and our future generations. Now, before I go into that, let me tell you what is my inspiration for doing this work. As Anne mentioned, I do a lot of work in advising governments in developing countries and in the West on how they can look at their tax laws, banking laws, customs laws, transfer pricing laws, so that the wealth is retained in those countries and doesn't leave the country. So the wealth is there to do its part. And one time I was in Guatemala and meeting with the finance minister of Guatemala, who had invited us to come there, Alberto Fuentes Knight. And I asked him, what is it that motivates you to do this? You know, your country has so much disparity in this, the very wealthy, the very poor, and you are here as finance minister trying to bring about changes. What is it that motivates you to do this? Because it is work that is quite risky and you're changing the status quo. And he said, let me tell you the story of my life, which is very simply, my father was the finance minister of Guatemala in the 80s. During the midst of the Guatemala Civil War, there was a 50-year civil war, and he was trying to make these reforms to make our country a more equitable and a just society. And he was murdered by the elite. He was assassinated. And my mother took me and my sisters to Mexico and then Canada, and raised me there, but told me that I could go back and complete my father's mission. I was educated abroad, but I came back, started business in Guatemala, got into politics, and then when President Colón became president in 2008, he invited me to be finance minister, and I'm now here doing this work. So it's people like those that inspire me to do what I'm doing, and as the subjects unfold, as the stories unfold, you will see what the fault lines are and what we need to do as global citizens. Now, as I said, I'll tell you a story. So I'm going to weave this through in things that affect all of you. You may think that, you know, multinational corporations, tax savings, all of it is all out there, but actually it affects all of you. So let me start with some basic examples. Now, one of the members in our family is very fond of bananas. Now, when you buy a banana, you look at the label, it says here, Chiquita, right? Now the two main importers of bananas into this country are Chiquita and Del Mar, right? Now when I was doing work in Guatemala, I was surprised to see that most of the land and plantations were owned by Chiquita and Del Mar. But the Guatemalan government is not receiving any tax revenue from them. And the more we drilled down, the more we discovered that Chiquita had 11 subsidiaries in the Bahamas. And Del Mar had 30 subsidiaries in the Cayman Islands. So when these bananas were grown, it was sold at a very small markup to their subsidiary in the tax haven, so that the Guatemalan government got very little tax revenue. And then that subsidiary in the Cayman Islands of Bermuda resold the bananas to UK and US at a high price, and then eventually when it went into the Food Emporium and Whole Foods and so forth, the markup there was very little. So the US got very little revenue, but the real profit stayed with Chiquita and Del Mar in the Bahamas and Cayman Islands. Now some of you who love bananas will remember the story, but that is the reality. Now, as a result of our research, as I said, I would make this a story based upon what you all experience. So as a result of the research, we publicized it, and The Guardian did an article called Bananas to the UK via the Channel Island. It pays for tax reasons. If you Google it, you will see how this process works. So basically, the developing country got very little tax revenue, the developed country got very little tax revenue, and the revenue really stayed in the tax havens. Now, let's go to something else. How many of you use Amazon to order books? How many of you go to Starbucks? How many of you use Google? Okay. Now, this is something that was a testimony taking place just last week in the British Parliament, in which Margaret Hodge, a member of Parliament, asked representatives of Google, Amazon, and Starbucks during a heated committee hearing why they were not paying any taxes in the UK. Why on earth do you manipulate your accounts so that you get away with not paying corporate tax in the UK? And she says, look, when I order things online, I order them on a British website, amazon.co.uk. The goods are delivered from British Air Warehouse via the British Royal Mail, but all the profits are going into Luxembourg, which is one of Amazon's subsidiaries in Europe. And she says, another interesting comment she had, we are not accusing you of being illegal. We are accusing you of being immoral. And I think there's some truth to that. Now, again, I'm building a story, so I'm not accusing any company. I'm just telling you what the facts are, because all of this, what I'm telling you, is public information. So nothing I'm saying is a surprise. Because if you follow the headlines, all I'm trying to do is weave the tapestry based upon what is in the news. Google. Here's an article from Bloomberg. Google's 2.4% rate shows how $60 billion was lost to tax loopholes. Google, I mean, you and I pay 15 to 35% tax rate, right? Google pays 2.4%. So Google, if it was paying its fair share, would be paying another $60 billion a year to the US Treasury and to the state treasury in California. And California, as you know, is laying off firemen and teachers and police people. How many of you use Microsoft? Now, this is from the US Senate, a letter sent by Senator Levin to all his fellow senators saying, if you're going to address the fiscal cliff, please let us address the loopholes that are there, which benefit just a few companies. And here's what he says in that testimony. Can I have some water?
Yes.
On October 12th, a subcommittee hearing illustrated how US multinational companies use profit shifting to dodge US taxes. This is Senator Levin talking. I have featured Microsoft as a case study. The hearing has shown how Microsoft developed computer software products in the United States using US research and development credits, credits that you and I fund, transferred the intellectual property rights in those products to offshore subsidiaries that it established in low tax jurisdictions, and thereby avoided billions of dollars in US taxes. Now, this is all public information. You know, for a while, I did not, my family will attest to it, I did not use, want to use Google or Microsoft. I thought the internet would go away. But the worst way it means it was here to stay. Here's another one. GE Strategies, here's another headline, the New York Times. GE Strategy. How many of you get GE appliances?
Oh.
All of you listening. GE Strategies let it avoid taxes altogether. Zero taxes, right? Now, this is information that, you know, some executives within these companies don't like it, so they go public, right? Here's a headline from Bloomberg. Caterpillar accused of demoting executive discovering a $2 billion tax dodge. So here's an executive who went to his management and said, you know, you guys are doing something unethical. Saving $2 billion by these tax dodges is not right. They demoted. Okay? US companies dodge $60 billion with Global Odyssey, which is, Apple is one of them, which is one of the companies. Apple has, in fact, $80 billion in tax havens sitting in foreign locations by its present policies. In fact, again, my family will attest for this. When my family got me a MacBook, for a while it was sitting on the shelf. I kept on telling them, I can't use it. If Apple has $80 billion in tax havens, how can I switch from my IBM ThinkPad? And IBM doesn't play these games, by the way. How can I switch? And they said, Dad, you're too old-fashioned, and you're too slow. And finally I gave up and started using it. Now, so I think you're understanding, you know, so it's not like the government is not aware of these problems. Government is aware. Google questioned by SEC over earnings in low tax countries. SEC is going after some of them. But you know, these companies have the lobbyists, and they are the best tax lawyers, and the best accountants, and they fight the SEC all they want, and occasionally a settlement will come out of it, and nobody will accept blame, and life goes on. Making corporate tax rules fair for all of this is in the news, you see it all the time, and now that we are reaching a fiscal cliff, I mean, just think of this. The US is reaching a fiscal cliff which could affect our economy, could go into a recession, but we're not addressing these problems. Same things is existing in Spain, in Greece, and so forth. As you know, Spain and Greece have a 25% unemployment right now. Youth unemployment, people in the ages of 20 to 30, have a 60% unemployment rate. 60%. Those countries are suffering as much as us because of these problems. And here is, you know, we are all accepting it as business as usual. Now, I can go through all of this, but basically, I think you get the message of what some of the challenges and what the problems are. Now, why is this important? Why is what we are talking about something that we all have to be concerned about? Why is this? There's a story of a professor who asked his students, if you had a choice between ignorance and apathy, what would you choose? Professor who asked his class, if you had a choice between ignorance and apathy, what would you choose? And somebody at the back of the class raised his hand and said, I don't know, and I don't care. We are here because we do want to know, and we do care. My heart went out to the people in Scranton, Pennsylvania, when the municipality of Scranton in July decided that they didn't have any money to pay its municipal workers. Some of them had been working for 10, 20 years. And they said, as of August 1, everybody is going to go on minimum wage. Can you imagine if you had been working for the city of Scranton, Pennsylvania as a fireman, as a, you know, municipal worker, trash delivery, whatever, working 10, 20 years, and suddenly they tell you, as of next Monday, ladies and gentlemen, you're going to be on minimum wage. If you don't like it, you're going to leave. Everybody's hurting. Municipalities are acting as though they are all broke. And in fact, one of the things that we did is we did a movie just to inform the public. And what's the title of this movie? We Are Not Broke. And this was the official selection at the Sundance Film Festival this year. So that people, and you can get this online, you can get on Amazon if you like. We are not broke. If you really try to get our arms around what is our fair share as a society, now you may say that, oh, it's okay that these companies have subsidiaries and tax havens, but their headquarters are in the United States, and everything must be kosher here. Everything must be above board, right? Wrong. Where are most of these companies incorporated? Somebody said Delaware, right? Have you ever wondered why most of these companies are incorporated in Delaware?
Low taxes.
Huh?
Low taxes.
No, it has low taxes, but there's a very good reason. Under Delaware law, if a company is incorporated there, any action of an executive of a company conducted while in office is free of indemnity. In other words, the executives of the companies cannot be sued for any actions while in office if their company is incorporated in Delaware. Now think of this. You know, yesterday I came from DC to New York, and every time the train stops in Wilmington, you know, I think of on 1204 Orange Street in Wilmington, one address, guess how many companies are registered there?
10,000.
10,000? Guess how many companies are registered at 1204 Orange Street in Wilmington?
20,000.
20,000? 217,000. These are all post office boxes there, in effect. So this is why 64% of the publicly held companies in which you are not investing are all registered in Delaware because of these lax laws. Now think of this one more way. Delaware collects from these companies, guess how much they collect in corporate franchise fees for the privilege of registering in Delaware?
$400 each.
They collect $860 million a year in corporate franchise fees from these people, from these companies registered in Delaware, and it costs them only $12 million to administer that department. To them, it's a grand casino. Every year, it costs them only $12 million to administer a corporate franchise tax department by keeping the tax laws so, the incorporation laws so lenient, and they collect $360 million. Now, other states are catching on. Wyoming has made its incorporation laws very lax to attract companies there. Nevada is doing the same thing. Florida is doing the same thing. It's a race to the bottom. Is that in your public interest, in your children's public interest? Now you may say, oh my gosh, but you know, they have their money in tax havens, and they're incorporated in Delaware. But of course, when they bring that money back to the US, they must be paying taxes on it at the 35% rate. One would imagine that they would, like, when you bring the money back. Right now the law says, as long as it's kept offshore, it's okay, but when you bring it back, you have to pay the tax. Logical, right? Wrong. Here's a headline from Bloomberg. What happens is, there are these companies who have all this money offshore. Every 3 or 4 years, they go to Congress with their lobbyists and say, you know, you want to create jobs in this country? We have all this wealth sitting abroad. We'll be happy to bring it if you give us a tax credit. So every 4 or 5 years, Congress passes a bill that says, instead of the 35% rate, please bring this money back to this country and you only pay 5%. So here's a headline. Google joins Apple, mobilizing lobbyists to push for tax holiday. Group pushes for corporate tax holiday, and they talk about Cisco and Pfizer and Apple and Microsoft, all of them pushing for tax holiday. Can you and I get a tax holiday? And New York Times, to its credit, came out with an editorial that said, can you read it?
No.
No holiday. So this issue is right in the public debate with the public disciplines. Because there are all of these lobbyists out there who are carving out what they want. Now, let's weave this tapestry a little further. In addition to incorporating in the United States, in Delaware, so that they are protected, under current US law, these companies are also allowed, under the law, to open corporations under nominee accounts or trust accounts so that you don't really know who really knows the corporation. The corporation, incorporation transparency is very vague. And so when these corporations open bank accounts, it's very hard to know who really owns this bank account under this nominee account in a company. So what this creates is a widespread amount of lack of transparency in corporate structure, and it creates, and with this lack of transparency in who really owns the account, we create a windfall of money that comes into this country, which we welcome because money is money, that is coming from a lot of illegal sources from abroad. Because banking laws and tax and these incorporation laws are very related and they're kept intentionally very vague. One of the persons on our advisory board is Robert Morgenthau. Does everybody know who he is? Mm-hmm. Famous DA of New York. The reason he joined our advisory board is because he said that he could investigate all the people that he wanted, but when it came to tracking their bank accounts in the United States and the shell companies that they have set up, he struck a board. Which is why he's our ally in this function. And in fact, Levin and Grassley introduced a bill called the Combat U.S. Corporation with Hidden Owners Act. But these bills are going nowhere because our Congress is at an impasse. It's too much of a divide. Good bills are being introduced, but it's going nowhere. It's affecting all of us. And a lot of wealth comes illegally from abroad. You know, during this presidential campaign, there was a lot of talk about illegal immigration and all these people flooding into our country. But what was lost in the debate is that our banks, American banks, have welcomed over the last 30 years about $870 billion of Mexico's wealth that the elite have brought into this country. $870 billion. Now imagine if that money had stayed in those countries. If our laws had been such that we are not welcoming illicit money from abroad, would a 12-year-old child be trying to cross the border in the middle of the night and her mother worrying if he's getting there alive? The government would have more tax revenue. The money would have been there to create more infrastructure and jobs and schools and hospitals and businesses. But because we welcome the money, elite in many developing countries use that opportunity to flood money into our countries And the country loses, and we don't necessarily gain, because illegal immigration becomes one of the other problems that we face. If you Google Krishen Mehta and banks, at that time I wrote an article in the Dallas Morning News, in the Texas papers it was published, which is headed, "Banks, not borders, hold the immigration people." Banks, not borders, hold the immigration people. And so the irony is that our legislative structure is captivated by these governments. Every person on the banking committee is financed by these institutions. You know, it's interesting, Tom Friedman, some of you follow his articles in the New York Times. An interesting article, it said, "US congressmen should have to dress like NASCAR drivers and wear the logos of all the banks, investment banks, insurance companies, and real estate firms that they're taking money from." The public needs to know. So everything I'm telling you as I read this tapestry, it's all in the public domain. I'm simply piecing it together in a way that makes sense for you. In fact, this is another interesting one. I have all of them. Here's one, former Prime Minister of Greece, George Papandreou. He's saying, "Greece would have avoided bailout if it were not for tax havens." There's a Prime Minister of Greece talking, right? Now, I could go on and on. You may say, well, okay, so we have problems with the incorporation sector, shell companies, we have banks that welcome other countries' money. We have tax havens, we have Delaware, but surely our other sectors of our economy are very good, right? Insurance companies. American Insurance Group, what does it stand for? AIG is American Insurance Group, right? How much did your money bail them out on? $180 billion. Bail them out. This company is the largest insurance company in the world, which the Obama administration didn't want to go under for good reasons. They operate in 130 countries, they're headquartered in the Bahamas, they pay very little taxes to these countries, but when they took a big gamble on the casino machine, which is in the Isle of Man, they sold some very aggressive derivatives that went under. The bailout was $180 billion, and it had to be paid in three installments because we didn't really know what the real scope of the damage was. You all had to pay it in three installments just to keep them afloat. Now, some people think that AIG stands for something else, like arrogance, ignorance, greed. But I don't agree with that. Now, you may think that the drugs and pharma companies are all above board, right?
No.
Thank you. Some of you, I don't know if you've read Joe Stiglitz's The Price of Inequality.
Yes.
In that book, he talks about how the drugs and pharma companies have worked out a deal with the legislators that on the drugs that they sell to Medicare, the US government cannot ask them any questions.
Right.
Basically, the US government is paying drugs and pharma companies an extra $50 billion a year, even though the US government is the primary client and primary customer. They passed a law that says, you cannot ask us any questions. What we charge you should be free of market and competitive pressures. Can you imagine? Built into the law. $50 billion over 10 years is $500 billion. It's not small change. Now you may think, okay, so insurance companies are like that, maybe drug pharma. What about our legal system? Our legal system is all about board, right?
Wrong.
You know why we attract all this illegal wealth from abroad? A legal system is designed such that there are only 200 cases of domestic crime in the United States, but only 11 of those 200 apply if the crime is committed abroad. So basically, if the crime is committed abroad, you can bring the money into this country because it's not a crime committed here. Somebody can actually walk into Credit Suisse or Bank of America legally, walk to the bank manager and say, here's $1 million from environmental crimes in Indonesia. Here's $1 million from tax evasion in Guatemala. Here's $1 million from trafficking in the Ukraine. And the banker can, under the law, legally say, oh, welcome. These are not crimes committed here, so we welcome your money. And we, as a coalition of NGOs, are working hard to have a harmonization of predicate offenses so in all the OECD countries, law committed, crime committed there is a crime here, and you cannot bring the money. You think the real estate lobby is above board? You hear about all these $200 million apartments on Fifth Avenue that have been bought by Russian oligarchs? I'll tell you a little story about that. When the US government passed the Patriot Act in 2001 after the 9/11 attacks, they wanted to put a stop to these money that was coming into terrorism and so forth. The real estate industry got very concerned that some of the money that was coming into the real estate sector that was illicit from abroad could be stopped. So they passed a special exemption for the real estate industry in the Patriot Act that says that any money coming into the real estate sector in the US economy is free or exempt from the know your customer requirement. In other words, money coming in, you don't have to know your customer, which is part of the laws in most of the jurisdictions. Money should be, there's an exemption for them, because of course they're very important. So you get the picture. Now, you can understand how all of this affects our future. And it puts our future at risk. As Mitch McConnell would have said, I'm sorry, Groucho Marx said, actually Mitch McConnell would have said it too, he said, why should I care about posterity? What has posterity ever done for me? I think that's the dilemma we're facing. Now, what can we do about it? Well, I'll just take 4 or 5 minutes and then we bring it to a closure. You've been a very kind and generous audience. One of the things we are working very hard is to work with Congress to pass legislation that affects these issues. In fact, historically, as you may be interested to know, that when Senator Levin first proposed this bill in 2006 to stop tax haven abuse, his co-sponsor was Senator Barack Obama. When that bill was proposed, the White House said, we're not interested. He has proposed this bill again. The White House is very interested, but there's gridlock. We're working on banking transparency, incorporation transparency, there's gridlock. But we're working. That's one area. Another area is, we're doing a lot of research so that the public is aware on what's happening in these areas, you know? From and you can get our information. Everything that we've done is on our website, but basically we analyze how illicit financial flows from developing countries for the last 10 years. We analyze how much it is. And then we track where it goes, privately held non-resident deposits in secrecy jurisdictions. We track how the money goes into Western economies and Switzerland tax havens, and guess how much that money is? $12 trillion. It's sitting there doing nothing for the global economy. And we're working hard and coming out with these research reports so that the public understands these issues. That's the second thing. Working in tax law, working in public awareness, in research. We do advocacy work. We go to the G20 every time there's a G20 meeting and we say, guys, you've got to put a stop to tax havens. You've got to put a stop to lack of banking transparency. Let's have more exchange of information among countries. Let's harmonize predicate offenses so that we are creating a better future. And I feel very passionate about these issues, which is why I've decided to devote the rest of my life to these areas, because this is important. We also are engaging, in addition to giving informational talks like these, we are engaging young people. This Monday, I was at Yale giving a talk in the Global Justice Program. People who are doing masters and PhDs in global justice. And I gave a talk on the subject. My talk was only from 6 to 8. And the students continued to talk to me till 10 p.m. until I had to leave to take the last train back to the city. They are very interesting. And in fact, when I left with them, I left with a very inspiring thought from Shakespeare. Because, you know, these students are going to be working on these issues, researching, being public advocates. And I said to them, remember that line from Shakespeare in King Lear, where it says, "We will take upon the mystery of things as if we were God's spies. We will take upon the mystery of things as if we were God's spies." I challenged them on this, and I'm sure if Dr. Adler was alive today, he would challenge them the same way. We could take on the mystery of things. So I thank you for this opportunity. I hope that this was helpful and useful to you, and I look forward to remaining engaged with the Ethical Society.